Paradigm Shift.
An educational comedy.
It's not a cause. Not a movement.
It's not a social group you can slap a label onto.
It's an idea. It's an intention.
It's an intuition.
A mindset in which reality can be explored.
Through genuine expression,
discernment,
critical thinking, and imagination.
To look inward upon ourselves.
To better understand the external world around us.
And yes,
human egos are bound to be bruised.
With our silly, strange, politically incorrect,
pure Caron Gilbert style of going about things.
Real and raw honesty.
Which invites you to be
you to the fullest.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to yet another edition of Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy. And on today's episode of Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy, we are going to be featuring Sean Caron, who is the host of the Awakening Liberty Show on Truth Frequency Radio. And he has on a special guest, and, you know, all of that information will, you know, be in the video description details and all that stuff, of course. But the reason I'm featuring it, I mean, aside from the fact that, you know, within, like, about the 90-minute mark of the show or so, not this video, but of the actual show, within the 90-minute mark, thereabouts, is when I'm brought on and I say a few words and stuff as well. But, you know, aside from my participation, one of the main reasons, probably the main reason, that I'm featuring it is because, as we all know, you know, within, you know, the truth movement, within various religions, within all these, you know, different groups and whatever, there's been a lot of division, people bickering back and forth, whether it's about, you know, who is or isn't a real Christian, or how 9/11 happened, or you know, flat earth versus globe earth, or whatever, and social justice warrior stuff and blah blah blah. You know, there's been all this you know, this division and bullshit, and people can't seem to really come together. And I've been saying for a while now that, you know, 2016 is, you know, the year of discovery, and so far I haven't really been disappointed, because, you know, for the first time ever, I'm actually seeing a unity start to happen. You know, we see it on TSU with, you know, what Sebastian Zumchick started, and Max Egan's bringing people together, and, you know, there's all this different stuff happening, and I feel that it is extremely important. I'm gonna kind of do an about face here. Okay, I feel that it's extremely important, and it's extremely amazing, and I know it's been blowing my mind, because obviously myself, just like the rest of you all, are, I'm sure, you know, used to the whole division thing, and you're probably just as annoyed, if not more annoyed by it, you know, than I am. And it's been an ongoing problem, and, you know, a lot of that gets you know, gets discussed on this radio show. And I just think it's really awesome that finally, you know, 2016, people are starting to come together. In 2011, even David Icke was saying that 2012 is not going to be the you know, the year to really pay attention to. 2016 is when things are really gonna start getting interesting. And, you know, so far that's been right. Also, I would like to bring to your attention that on June 25th, 2016, at 2 p.m. Pacific time, we're gonna be having a TSU roundtable on Truth Frequency Radio on the Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Caron. And there's going to be me, Dave Kelso, of course, and we're going to have Katarina Roy, and we're going to have Jennifer Kodak, and we're going to have Richard Hamilton, and most likely Kristen Meyer's going to be showing up. You know, there's all these different people. Sitting Bull, that's the pseudonym of one of the members of the hacking group Anonymous. Has been doing a lot on TSU and so on and so forth. And we're going to be talking about, just the state of the world and the unity that's been happening and all the paradigm shifts and just, you know, it's going to be really awesome. So, make sure you check that out. That's going to be on June 25th. That's Sunday, 2 p.m. Pacific time, so it's 4 p.m. Central time, and that's going to be on Truth Frequency Radio, on Internet Radio, and of course they have an FM station in Denver, and they have another station in Oregon, and wherever else they might be, syndicated and whatever. So, it's going to be pretty awesome. It's going to be pretty cool. Check that out. But without further ado, here is the internet radio show episode that I stopped over on for a few minutes, and I really hope you enjoy it, and I hope that it inspires you as much as it's inspired me. Thank you.
Truth Frequency Radio.
From the biggest little city in the world in the clear blue waters of Lake Tahoe, broadcasting from an undisclosed location in the Truckee River Valley on Truth Frequency Radio, this is the Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Caron. So it's another day in the trenches of fighting the New World Order agenda and these wacko psychopaths who have hijacked humanity, the whole world, not just our country. So I want to welcome everybody today to the Awakening Liberty Show. It's great to be back behind the microphone again today, as I do every Saturday and Sunday at 2 p.m. Pacific time. You are tuned into truthfrequencyradio.com, your protection from deception. All across America, all around the world, the number to call in is 866-37-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-378-7884. And real quick, I just want to mention the AwakeningLibertyShow.com website. That's AwakeningLibertyShow.com. I got a lot of great guests coming, so if you're interested in what's coming up in the next month and two, gosh, I'm booked all the way out to the end of July already. It's just been a frenzy. Lots of great stuff coming on. Gwen Olson, Scott Bennett. We're going to have Jeff Hayes, author of Rise of the New World Order, The Culling of Man, which is a great book. Well, very factual, and it lays out this whole great plan, this whole agenda, and he does it from a Christian perspective, which is very unique in much of the publications you find out there about the New World Order and the Illuminati and all that stuff. So that's going to be a great show. Also, Tony Rook, he has produced a new documentary called Incontrovertible, and it's basically a 9/11 documentary. A great film. He's going to be on the show June 26th, I believe. So stay tuned for that, because, like I said, I got a lot of great guests. Go to AwakeningLibertyShow.com, and you can check out all of my my upcoming guests and all of my upcoming events. Also, check out my Stack of Truth, and there's a direct link there for the Awakening Liberty store, so stop by there, and it's never been a better time. If you are interested in preparing your family for, God forbid, a total financial collapse or any kind of disaster, floods, blizzards, earthquakes, whatever, if you need some emergency preparedness food, I got 10% off until July 30th. Use coupon code FATHER. Again, that's coupon code FATHER, all lowercase. Get 10% off your entire order. You know, yesterday we had a solutions-oriented show, and that's what we're going to do today as well. And we're going to kind of, this is both sides of the spectrum. You know, yesterday we talked about the Jeffersonian nullification, his ideal of actually reining in and out of control federal government. Today we're going to look at the Madison perspective. I've got David Zuniga on the show today, and it's just an honor and a privilege to have him on the show. He established America Again in 2009, then wrote this Bloodless Liberty in 2010, and the book conveying his vision for the revolutionary Christian organization America Again. Its overall strategy is aimed at just arresting the Washington, D.C. organized crime and the D.C.'s control over our lives. And he states that even with only half of 1% of the population as members, that we can accomplish this. His book in 2015, Fear the People, is the detailed action manual for this mission. And basically he states it's his ministry. The PDF is available online at AmericaAgain.net, and I've been reading the book. I'm just absolutely fascinated by it. AmericaAgain.net, it's very, very exciting. And David has been a guest on InfoWars Nightly News, many radio programs across America, and again, I'm very privileged to have him on my show. His blog articles appear on blogs, forums, and alternative media, including Freedom Outpost, Sons of Liberty Media, The Washington Standard, Guns in the News, Prepper Recon, and DC Clothesline, The Liberty Beacon, and many others. So without further ado, I want to welcome David Zuniga to the show. How are you today, David?
I'm well, Sean. Thanks.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for sharing this information, and thank you so much for what you're trying to do, and obviously promoting America Again, because I don't think anybody can say that we are not faced with an overbearing, tyrannical, federal, centralized government these days, and it's a daunting task trying to figure out how we can actually do this, and so many people ask that question, what can we do?
Well, we can do a lot, and frankly, they were asking that question in the election of 1800.
Mm-hmm.
Jeffersonian republicanism, back then it was called the Republican Party. It was the first Republican Party, the real party of the Republic that Jefferson and Madison founded. People were asking the same thing under the Adams administration when things got very wild, which was really Hamiltonian federalism. And Hamilton was the father of what we have today. Hamilton's, the fact that his crypt is on Wall Street is very, very fitting because he was the father. And I'll talk a little bit more about Hamilton in a minute. But I guess to give an overview of America Again and what we're looking at, I'll have to cover a lot of ground. We have 2 hours, right?
Yes, we do.
Okay, perfect. Because it really is more than a one-hour show to do this, the intro to what America Again is. It's the only full-spectrum solution in the Republic. And, you know, real popular sovereignty only exists in theory, and it only exists in our constitutional rule of law. Nowhere else on the earth does it exist, even in theory. But in theory, it exists here. If you read the Constitution, you see that it begins, we the people, .. do ordain, and then we go and we ordain these servants, right, in three branches. And then we limit them. We ordain them first. We create them. Then we define them very carefully. Then we enumerate their powers, very limited powers. And so, and then we close the door with the Ninth and Tenth Amendments on any accretions or whatever that they might pull on us. So real popular sovereignty we're supposed to have. That means that the people are sovereign. Not that sovereignty is popular, but popular means of the people. Okay, so in a republic this large, in a republic this complex, there is no republic as complex as ours today. It never has been one as complex as ours. you need some pretty complex functions. You need a lot of stuff to go on, and that's what America Again staff, God willing and God providing, is going to perform over the years. Okay, but before even getting into any of what it is, let me start with some real basic groundwork, some fundamental things, and I'll break it down into five facts. This is kind of like, I know you've been reading my latest book, Fear the People, Sean. So this is kind of a very short summary of chapter one, okay? It's some basics. So the first point of five. Our fundamental war today for America isn't left-right. It really isn't. It's not black versus white. It isn't atheist versus Christian. It's not even sexual deviance versus normal people. That's not the war. The real war, it's been raging since Dishonest Abe took office, and as I said earlier, it's really been raging since Hamilton, since the ink wasn't even dry yet on the Constitution. But the war is Washington, D.C. versus America. So remember that. Folks, if you don't get that part, everything else starts falling through cracks and getting twisted around, and you're not seeing the sides. So first point. The war is Washington, D.C. versus America. We just did a three-minute video. Our newest video on YouTube is a three-minute that goes to that. It's a kinetic typography video, you know, a bunch of moving words. Mm. Washington, D.C. versus America. Get that, okay? Not ISIS, not Russia, not China, not anybody or anything else. It's Washington, D.C. versus us, okay? And Washington, D.C., and Sean, you know, your listeners certainly know this, is the most ruthless, powerful, criminal city-state in history. It has crushed populations in, you know, say you take about the last, let's say, 125 years since right before the sinking of the USS Maine, Spanish-American War. Mm. About 45 countries we have gone, this military, this D.C. organized crime has gone in and crushed and invaded all of these countries. Like, if you go back and read Roman history, the Roman Empire, that's what D.C. does. It goes, it crushes this area, it creates military outposts, it mans those outposts, it leaves them there. We've got 700 of those in our name all over this earth, and every last one of them is illegal. They cannot exist by law. They cannot be there.
I think it's 134 countries we have military bases in. I mean, talk about imperialism.
Every one of them is totally, you know, if we understand who we are, we're the apex sovereigns over this government, we're not supposed to be allowing that. And yet, you go to any Veterans Day thing and all you see is people flying their flags and support the troops and support all this stuff. And there's a lot of jobs, you know, both overseas and here. So anyway, not one of these, though. Remember, this enemy is Washington, D.C., see? And they not only have us occupied, they have the world occupied. This isn't us, folks. This isn't us occupying the world. It's Washington, D.C. Get that straight. All right, the second point. The U.S. Constitution isn't a piece of parchment. It's not some, you know, beloved, whatever, tradition or something. It's the supreme law. It's the highest law we have. There, you know, people are so chicken of the tax code. I'm not, but I mean, people are so chicken of the tax code or of a lot of federal laws. There's no federal law more serious, more authoritative than the U.S. Constitution. It's the highest law. And remember, it is a law of limitation on our servants. And guess who's over that law? Guess who is the only party that's over that law? Read the first three words. We the people.
Right.
Okay? So if we don't get this right, if we don't even know who the heck we are, we don't understand our popular sovereignty. And that's a collective sovereignty, by the way, folks. That doesn't mean that each of us is a little queen or a little king, you know. Collectively, we are the sovereign. We have to get this done ourselves. Don't go waiting for your quote-unquote elected leaders. They're not leaders. They don't lead you. They've never led you except into perdition. So, okay, so this law, second point, the U.S. Constitution isn't a piece of parchment. It is law. It's not a law to control us. It's a law where we the people create, define, and limit our servants, okay? So that leads me now to point three. When you're looking at electoral whatever, you know, political activism, electoral politics, all of that. That's not this. Okay, America again is law enforcement, and law enforcement isn't anything like politics. It's not like elections. You don't, you know, you don't need majorities to go out and enforce the law. No, it's usually a very small group of people who are trained to do that, who take a lot of hits, you know, for doing that. And law enforcement isn't a popularity contest, and it isn't a majoritarian function. So when you understand and you read Article 1, Section 8, Clause 15, and you say, oh, what does that mean there? It says that the militia is to execute the laws of the Union. What does that mean? Well, it means bad stuff, and it means stuff you've never even tried to do before, and you don't know how to do it, and you wouldn't know where to start, right? So we have work to do. So point number three again.
Let me ask you a real quick question, because this always comes up to me, and people want to they talk about Article 1, but Article 1, correct me if I'm wrong here, but Article 1 was never ratified correctly or properly. Is that the case?
I've never heard that assertion.
I actually see – I was looking at something earlier online, and it was talking about Article 1 and Article 2 having never been
– No. We're going to – no, don't jump ahead.
Okay.
You're talking about Amendment 1. Yeah, we're going to talk about that in a minute.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the First Amendment, yes, and that's a really cool thing, and we'll get into that. No, the first article is the article wherein we define – And we define the legislative branch. So, okay, so point number three, remember, law enforcement isn't like electoral politics, so you don't have to say, oh, man, we don't have enough, you know, this guy is a nut, man. He's talking about us doing all these law enforcement things. Most people won't do that. Most people don't have to do it. Like Sean told you just a few minutes ago, with 0.5%, that is a surplus for what we're talking about. And I'll get into how we do it in a minute, but you don't need very many people to be involved in something like America Again in popular sovereignty. Very few people can get it done, okay? That's point number three. So it's not a popularity contest, okay? And you really have to remember that, because every time you think, oh man, we don't have enough people, and you know, look at how dumb most people are, and they don't want to do anything. Don't worry about that. That has been the case since Socrates argued about it. You know, people are dumb and they sit on their hands. Don't worry about that. That's human nature. Okay. So our criminals our servants are criminals, right? And they're milking us, and they're stealing our civilization, and they're screwing up the whole wide world, and they're using our name to do it. And we're really pissed about it, but we don't know any, you know, everything we've tried, nothing has worked, right?
Right.
So what we really need to do, if it's really law enforcement, and if we believe in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 15, where it says execute the laws of the Union, what we should be doing is, if somebody's committing a multi-billion or multi-trillion dollar crime, they ought to be serving prison time and have their assets seized, right? I mean, that's duh. Okay. But that's a later stage. That's when we grow up and get smart, and we have everything lined up, as I'll talk about later in the program. First, you have to, and we call that the America Again indictment engine, and it's going to be a mobile platform app that's going to be the most, the coolest, most powerful app. It's going to change life in America more fundamentally than whatever, than Facebook or whatever. So using that app and using our legal staff, restoring our liberty and restoring limited government the way you see it, and the way we called for it, stipulated in the Constitution, that's not going to require even 0.5% of the population, okay? So just so you know, there's an app out there that we're developing called the Indictment Engine, and that's coming. And so you say, well, how do we do it? Well, that's coming. First, we have to do some other stuff that I'll talk about in a minute. So America Again, if you want to think, well, what is it? It's a new way of life. It's a new way of looking at who you are as a, you know, who we are as the people, and who they are as our servants, okay? So we need to be repentant, we need to be responsible, and we need to figure, all right, we're a remnant. We're just going to be not many. We're going to be the few. That's okay. That's cool. Don't worry about that part. All right, so if you're the sovereigns and you've got 1 million people or 500,000 people, that's a lot of people to get stuff done. You don't need to be NRA and have 5 million members to do what we're talking about. You can do it with $500,000. Okay, so, and the stuff we're going to be, it's in, we'll be doing, it's going to be enforcing the Constitution. Our arrogant, corrupt servants aren't going to like it. So they're going to strike back, and they're going to fight back hard. They're going to fight back dirty, all that. But you know what? It just like when, you know, when you see criminals, a gang or whatever, and they start fighting, really fighting back more publicly where you can really see them, things just tend to get worse for them. Over time, it's just going to get worse for them. So once this thing turns, once we get a critical mass of people going, aha, and I don't care if they're liberal, I don't care if they're conservative, I don't care if it's an atheist or a Christian, when they do the aha thing, and they read my book, and if they can get through the Christ stuff, because I do talk about the Lord a lot, he's, to me, it's just the nature of the universe. But still, if you can get through that and say, okay, blow off all of that, look at what the guy's talking about with respect to civics and law, it's simple. Mm-hmm. We've just been missing it for a really long, this is fifth and sixth and seventh grade homeschool civics. That's what this is. So, and it's not politics, remember that. All right, so that was point number three, kind of long, sorry. Law enforcement isn't politics, okay? But here's a corollary to that one. Point number four is the thing that, you know, when I said we're the only ones on earth that have this, maybe we're the only ones that ever can, I don't know. But we the people, the thing that makes us so unique here in this country, even if you came from somewhere else, you know, and you immigrated here legally and all that stuff, or your parents did or whatever, and you say, okay, but now I'm an American. Okay, what makes you different? What gives you different power here? Completely different from any island or mainland country anywhere on earth is that we the people created that law. See, you know how it starts, we the people. We stipulate everything in that law, and we're the only human authority above it, like I said a minute ago. Not the Supreme Court. When people think that the Supreme Court can come up with a ruling that just, oh no, we all throw our hands up in the air. You know what? We are absurd. In my book on pages, I think 20 through 22, I think it is, or 19 through 21, something like that, I talk about this. It's Article 3, Section 2, Clause 2, where we the people tell Congress, okay, you also have this authority. You can put whatever reservations or restrictions on the Supreme Court you want. We give Congress the authority over the Supreme Court, guys. Have you ever seen that, Article 3, Section 2, Clause 2? Go read the Constitution.
Absolutely.
We never had to have Roe v. Wade. We never had to have Obergefell v. Hodges. We never had to have the Obamacare ruling. Any of these things where people, these legislators talk, oh, activist courts, activist. They can stop those activist courts tomorrow. All they have to do is pass a law saying, from now on, subject matter jurisdiction over health care, over abortion, over marriage, over this are out of bounds. That is no longer your – that's it. That's the law. The Supreme Court has to live with that. We've got that in the Constitution. It's been in there for 228 years, guys. Right. Okay, so anyway. So the – interesting and the powerful thing about point number four is that we're the top of the pecking order, folks. We're not at the bottom. We just feel like we're at the bottom. Okay, so don't call them. If you start to say the term elected leader, stop yourself, okay? Don't ever use the word our leaders for those people. They work for you. They're our servants. If you ever serve, if you ever get elected to Congress, hopefully you will serve in the House once we have 6,400 seats. We'll talk about that in a minute. Once the House is 15 times bigger, like George Washington and all the founding fathers wanted it, and we're going to talk about that in a minute, then many of us will serve because guess what? We're also not going to go to Washington, D.C. to serve. We're going to serve from our town. So anyway, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So there's a very different world we're right on the cusp of it, okay? And that's what America, again, is. It's just kind of, whoa, once you look at it as a whole piece, you go, man, we could have done this like 100 years ago. Yeah, we could have, but we didn't. So, you know, the pharaohs could have had air conditioning. They didn't. Whatever.
Right.
So the Indians could have had A-10 warthogs, but they didn't. So anyway, we're there. We're at a point now where if we don't do this, we're We are insane if we don't do this. And the world is watching us right now to see what the Americans will do. That's why I'm a missionary to this crazy, weird tribe. Because it's just, I see all these great people, these really, you know, on fire people who are so upset right now. But there's so there's so many brilliant people in this country. And I meet them every week and I go, oh, man, we've got, it's amazing what we've got here and we're not using it. Anyway, what in chapter one of my book, Fear the People, you can get it online. Go to americaagain.net. Go to the bottom of the homepage. Look on the lower right. There's a blue big square rectangular button. Says PDF book. Click it. You can get the book for free. Or you can go buy it at Amazon for $43.50. I don't care which one you do. But I like the PDF better because I also show you, we also have a link in there to a an e-reader. So you can, you know, have it read to you as you commute or whatever. And also because all the links are live in the PDF book, whereas if you buy the paperback, you know, you don't have the links. So I prefer to give it to you, if you will. So, and in chapter one, I explain words like, don't use words like democracy ever again. Don't use terms like our leaders ever again. Don't ever call yourself grassroots. That's like a little worm underfoot. That's not who we are. Don't ever talk about revolution. That's absurd. Or saying, I'm against the government. No, you're not. You're the top level of government. In this republic, you're the top level of government. Just because you're abdicating and you're ignorant doesn't mean you're not the top level of government. So get with it. Okay, so, and the federal government that does exist is only what we stipulate in Article 1, Section 8. Nothing else, no other function, no other agency, no other bureau, no other anything that is not stipulated there is federal government. That is organized crime. It's not federal government. Just because it uses, has, you know, trucks and cars with DC, you know, or federal government seals on the doors or what. No, I mean, this is organized crime, folks. So once you start getting that and internalizing that, and I believe once we get Trump in the White House, not that I like the guy personally, but I just think he's cool because he knows how to kick butt. He knows how to kick at the gate, you know, that needs to be kicked at. We just, once we get that, this is going to start happening so fast, it's going to make DC's head spin. Hopefully spin right off. Okay, yeah. So that brings me to the last point.
Here, let's hold on because we're going to be coming up on a break here. And I want to talk a little bit with you about Trump and Hillary because, good grief, this whole political theater, I think it's all an illusion of choice. I actually think Hillary is going to be the next, as I've said before on the show, selected, not elected, president by these bankers and the people who are running the shadow government. It certainly appears that that's the case. When we come back, we've gone through points 1 through 4. When we come back from the break, I want to get into point 5, and we're going to talk about a whole lot more here with David Zuniga. Great to have him on the show. And we're really talking about solutions today and what we can do to arrest this criminal crime organization that is Washington, D.C. The Awakening Liberty Show with my guest, David Zuniga. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Frequency Radio is your number one source for news and information without the hate, hype, and fear. We are proud to bring you cutting-edge programs like The Kev Baker Show, The Freedom Link with Joe Joseph, Truth Frequency with Chris and Sherry Geo, The Christopher Everard Show, X-Squared with Brooks Agnew, Down the Rabbit Hole with Popeye, Freaky Friday with The Woo Crew, Waking Up the Masses with Robert Bruce, Phoenix Rising Radio, and dozens more. Did you know you can listen from any computer, mobile device, or from any telephone by dialing 832-225-5308. Or call into your favorite show toll-free at 866-37-TRUTH. Uncensored talk and news you won't hear in the mainstream media. 24 hours a day. Truth Frequency Radio. We are TFR. Your protection from deception.
For over 3,000 years, we've been in the background, controlling governments from behind the scenes and creating a new world order. However, we are losing the war and we need your help. Join the Illuminati now. Travel the world injecting poor brown-skinned people with vaccines. Steal their oil and their gold. Or perhaps you'd like a job as a farmer, growing genetically modified corn, which we make into oil and sell it with no label. Or if you've ever wanted to be a pilot, you could join our chemtrails project. You'd be in the air all the time then. Oh yes, it's time to join the Illuminati. Oh, and don't forget to like us on Facebook.
We are submersed in a construct that was designed to break us and keep us broken. But it hasn't. It failed. We still go on because we were designed from an eternal template of infinite creativity and not a synthetic house of cards built on pride and false power. Breaking free from the programs and paradigms that hold us down takes courage, endurance, tenacity, and trust. The reason it is so hard is because to be a free and sovereign being, we have to smash every lie, even if it hurts. It is good to be reminded of how resilient, unbreakable, magnificent, and powerful we truly are. And if anything provides a foundation for that, it is the book, Our Universal Journey. Go to ouruniversaljourney.com.au.
Agent for Truth with Joe Bannister. Saturday on Truth Frequency Radio.
I'll bust it one time. Truth and liberty. Fight the new world order and the tyranny. The Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Caron.
And welcome back to segment two of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on Truth Frequency Radio, your protection from deception. The number to call in all across America, all around the world, 866-37-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-378-7884. If you have any questions or comments for David or myself, feel free to call. I'm going to open up the lines in the second hour. So just stay tuned for that. I will get you on the show when I see you call in, because I know people are going to have questions out there for David. I certainly do. And David, before we get into point five, we covered point four, one through four in the previous segment. I wanted to pose a question to you. Because you were talking about the ignorance of we the people and the fact that much of that and much of the situation that we are in comes from apathy. It comes from lack of knowledge. It comes from educational indoctrination or mainstream media propaganda, the lack of enforcement by we the people. Have we the people become we the problem in this country?
No, we haven't become the problem. We've always been the problem.
Always been the problem.
Like I said, Socrates complained about the same thing. Most people really are fairly inert. That's always been the case in every culture. But the difference is here, like Franklin said to Lady Powell when she said, "What kind of a government have you given us, Dr. Franklin?" And he said, "A republic, if you can keep it." And he really put his finger on it. I mean, it really is up to us. But then when you look at the first 40 or 50 years after, ratification of this new constitutional system, we really didn't, the people out there just really didn't take advantage of what was built in to the document. But Let me get into point number five, because it's so perfect for what we're talking about here. And point number five is this. Contrary to popular belief, including what we've just said right now, this is the best time in our history to be alive, especially as an American. And the best is yet to come if America again goes, or when America again goes to scale. And I know you talk a lot. I know this channel, this group that you're a radio group that you're a part of, talks a lot about the rulers of evil, as F. Tupper Saucy used to call them in his book by that title. Very good book. There's about 1,980 billionaires in this republic. And those people really must laugh their heads off, you know, watching 320 million people going at one another, you know, Mortal Kombat every day, every year, especially every 2 years. And it's just so pathetic, you know. And so anyway, this is why I say I'm a missionary, because if you look at this from the outside, you try to say, okay, take yourself out of time and out of all of this and just look back at what we have as a people and what we have in this constitutional system. And what we have, this internet is like the movable type printing press on steroids with wings and rocket engines, man. I mean, it's amazing what we have right in front of us, and we're not using it. I mean, we are using it, but for stupid things, you know, as well as we also, though, I look at tech and I look at what's happened in our lives, and I just see an amazing kind of life today. I really look at the glasses half full, and I do say, even before America again goes to scale, this is still the best time in our history, and I'm going to explain why I say this, to be alive on this earth. Now, okay, so my job is to get these 5 points, especially that last one, and I believe they're all facts, get those to the responsible remnant, the people that say, okay, I've heard what you're saying, I'm going to do something about it. Okay, I'm going to take responsibility. Those are the people I talk to. I don't talk to the ones that, like you say, Sean, have always existed, and they're the problem right now, but they've always been the problem, and that's people that they hear it and they go, meh, you know, they're too busy or whatever. Or they just think, I don't really believe what that guy's saying. I don't think I can really change it. So my team's job is to lead Americans first to repent and then to get to work. And get to work smarter than our enemies are working, or else why work? You know, you're just
absolutely
beating our head against the wall. So I wake up with a smile every day, and I do it in light of eternity. Because Christ saved me. So I'm, you know, as a Christian, I look at stuff kind of in a really, I've got a much bigger framework and all that. But I'm not called to be an evangelist. I mean, I don't pitch God to everybody and all that. I don't. I mean, he's the creator and sustainer of the universe. Hey, whether you like it or not, I don't see any point in pushing, you know, in being apologetics and all that as argumentation. Now, if somebody wants to know and say, hey, what about this Christ or Yeshua or whatever they call him, you know, and I'll say, okay, fine, I'll talk to him then. But my calling in this missionary work is to say, look, embrace this new way of life. It's been sitting here for 227 years. We just haven't taken it up. Let me show you, and that's what this book, Fear the People, is about. Each chapter opens a certain area, and I show you, look, this is basic civics, guys. We should have always known this, but since nobody teaches it anymore, here, I'll give it to you. See what you think. Hey, you want to do this? You want to do this, and if there's 200,000 of us, we change the world? How about it? Let's try. I mean, or we can stay stuck on stupid. You know, we're a Neolithic tribe here. I mean, it's loony to just wait. So once I saw this stuff, let me get into how I saw this stuff. I'm an engineer by training. I was a professional engineer designing buildings, architectural engineer for almost 30 years. And I did a lot of other stuff. I mean, I was a cattleman, a home builder, commercial contractor, but mostly I was an architectural engineer. And, I was a missionary pilot in New Mexico. I edited books for a book publisher. I founded 4 K-12 classical Christian schools in 3 states. So I've done a bunch of different stuff where I've learned a lot. And I had a classical education myself where I read a great deal. So at age 60, 61 now, I mean, I've read a lot of stuff and learned a lot of stuff, and I intend to act on it. So 15 years ago, that morning of 9/11, when I started watching the first collapse, you know, I'm looking at a free fall velocity, axial, perfect axial implosion, you know, pyroclastic debris clouds, everything that's does not say fire-induced collapse of a steel structure.
Right.
I mean, just this was crazy. As an engineer, I'm looking and thinking, I when I was at UT, at University of Texas Austin, they taught us about, I remember reading about in 1945 when that B-25 Mitchell bomber flew right into the 78th through the 80th floors of the Empire State Building. That was on a Saturday, and that next Monday, that building was open again. So I'm saying, all right, now here's an aircraft. Oh, here's Building 7. No impact, you know, and the thing, perfect axial implosion, free fall. Like, come on, guys. Really, collapse mechanics, the laws of physics, material science, none of it made sense. So I said, all right, this is Orwell. This is USS Maine, HMS Lusitania, Pearl Harbor, Tonkin Bay, same deal. So what do we do about it? And that took me just from being really, really ticked off that day to knowing what to do about these powerful, ruthless people. Took me about 7 years of reading. And then I shut down my engineering practice and bought a little old RV and stuck it under a big oak tree in the Texas Hill Country and had a monastic period of about 14 months, pulled in 110 books, and I don't know how many, every website I could get, and every piece of founding father's documentation I could find. And I just studied my rear off for 14 months and said, okay, let's find out where the holes are in their side. How do we get this back? How do we turn this around? We already know who it is. It's the people that own the members of Congress. It's the people that control presidents. It's not presidents. So we all know that. I mean, all of us, even kind of the naysayers, really in their heart of hearts, they understand. They're very wealthy, very powerful people on Earth. They're evil people. They're really bad people. They teach their grandchildren to lord it over your grandchildren, and they always will. That's just, there's a kind of human that's like that, and there's always been that way. So get over that. How do you beat them? So that's what I did for those 14 months. How do we beat them? And I found out you don't go after them.
Right.
You go after the only part that there's one nexus for all of this, the U.S. Congress. You go get that Congress, and you get the game. So that's where we've got a law. Of the 22 proposed reform laws we have, you can read them in Chapter 12 of my book, Fear the People. There's 22 laws that we want to – this is, you know, taking back everything we've lost over the last 150 years. That's what those 22 laws are. The first one is called the Bring Congress Home Act, and that one is the big one. And we ram it through Congress, and I'm going to tell you how we do that. Let me just get into that now. How do we pass the Bring Congress Home Act? Which, by the way, there was a proposed. It was called the Mobile Act, and it was Eric Swalwell, Democrat of California, and Mike Pierce, Republican of New Mexico, back in 2013, wanted to do a Bring Congress Home kind of thing. Because those guys were from the West and had to do a lot of traveling every week, and said, "Hey, this is dumb, guys. Here, you know, we're in the 21st century. We ought to, you know, do." So anyway, it didn't go anywhere, and it won't, because Washington D.C. is a monstrous, huge business, and it will not shut itself down. We have to shut it down.
Right.
So, and fear porn isn't going to get it done, folks. And by that I mean, I'm not talking about you. Present company and a lot of others accepted, but the whole conservative talk radio thing that Limbaugh founded 30 years ago that never presents solutions, that always works on the limbic system. And it's interesting that his name is Limbaugh, because the limbic system of the brain is the one, you know, it's the part that is goosed by fear and by anger,
I told that to somebody, and they absolutely thought I was nuts.
Well,
I was a huge Rush fan, and your point.
I was too for 15 years. I was his biggest fan. Yeah, I really was.
The whole conservative talk radio: Rush, Levin, Hannity, and to some extent Savage.
They're all Alex Jones.
This false left-right paradigm. And even NPR on the other side of the aisle is doing the same thing. It's all divide and conquer, Cloward and Piven, keep us all fighting.
Exactly.
I'm so exactly. That
And so when you see, you know, there's a group right now out there called represent.us. I recommend their website. They're raging liberals. Raging liberals. They're for homosexuality and all the stuff I don't like. But they're very effective at what they are doing, and they're going after local and state corruption, and they're doing a great job of it. They wear bright yellow shirts with black lettering, and it says represent.us. And again, I'm not saying that I totally agree with everything they do and believe, but I am for what they are doing, and I believe that they are going to help us in our first step, which is now we'll get into, Sean, what you were talking about, the First Amendment to the Constitution. If you go look at the original Bill of Rights, as it was written, there were 12 points. There were 12 articles. And Article the First, the original First Amendment, was that you can't have, that districts can't be over 50,000 people.
Right.
It says 30,000, and then after there were 100 members of the House, it could go to 1 to 40,000, and then after there were 200 members of the House, it could go to 1 to 50,000. Well, that was passed, that was ratified by only 11, well, arguably 12 states. Connecticut didn't get their paperwork right. The House and Senate didn't agree in time, and anyway, it's a big mess. I have a discussion of that called the Lost First Amendment in appendix like K or L or something in the book, and I explain the history behind that amendment. But that amendment, what they wanted there was the opposite of what we have, these huge districts that are all gerrymandered like a, you know, an amoeba with a broken back and stuff, where people, it's so big, 750,000 people in one district. Give me a break. I mean, you can't represent that many people. You can't ever know that many people. So when we bring districts down to 50,000 or fewer, what's going to happen? How many do we have? We'll end up with 6,000 for at today's, at, you know,
right,
the size of our population, we would end up with between 6,250 and 6,400 members of the House. And people freak out and they get all upset. Oh, we don't need more. You know, we already have too many politicians. They don't understand what this is. So let me walk you through how that would look. First, let me walk you through how we would get them home, because that's what we would do. We would bring them home, and then it won't seem so bad. Because you know what we already have at home? We have 7,383 legislators in our states. Did anybody know that number? It's over 7,000 legislators. And nobody's saying, oh, we have too many, we have too many. Now, I think we do, but but right. All I'm saying is, at the state level, we already have 7,383, but we only have 435 at the federal level. And let me tell you, in 1929, the Reapportionment Act of 1929 was essentially the hijacking of the Constitution, if they hadn't already hijacked it in 1862 by saying, oh, money? That's going to be paper now. You know, so the Congress can't do that, but we let them do that. We let them do it in 1862. Why? Because we were getting blown to hell. The country was at war with itself, because the North – read a book called A Century of War by John Denson. Fantastic book.
It's a great book.
I have six books. In my chapter 4 of Fear the People, I take six books into that chapter, and I explain how – what a monster Abe Lincoln was. Now, he was not alone. He was just as much a puppet as Bush 2 and as, you know, Carter and as, you know, all of them. All of Bush 1, certainly Clinton, certainly Obama, all of them. They're tools. They're tools. Woodrow Wilson, big time.
Yeah.
So, but Lincoln was the worst, the very worst. And I try to prove that in that chapter. And I show you that was the watershed. That's where we forgot who we were. And we totally caved because why? There were armies coming into our backyards. They were burning our fields. They were burning our whole towns. Imagine whole towns. Think of this, Sean. There were 750,000 deaths, military deaths. So if you take those numbers and extrapolate to what our current population, you'd have 7.3 million deaths today. Can you imagine what that would be like if that happened in 4 years today? Mm-hmm. 7.3 million Americans having killed one another and whole towns burned to the ground. You know, so you have to realize what happened to us there. And people don't get that. Why? Because they don't study it anymore.
Yeah.
Nobody studies that war. I mean, it was what I call the war to
slavery. War to enslave. I mean,
war to enslave the states is what I call it, because that's the most accurate name for it, because it enslaved the parties to the Constitution and made them into these mendicant little beggars. So the states just turned into something completely foreign, and then the 17th Amendment nailed that coffin shut.
Right,
and so we're all backwards now. But you know what? We can fix this in an amazingly short period of time.
Let me ask you a quick question, because this gets posed to me all the time, because Lincoln certainly did some very nefarious things, and he was obviously being controlled by the powers that be, whatever you want to call them, this whole Rothschild, Rockefeller, Morgan banking stuff, the whole families of the 13 banking Illuminati families, whatever you want to call them. But Lincoln seemed to have, towards the end of his presidency, before his assassination, he seemed to realize that he'd made a grave error and then tried to fight the central banks.
He created he was fighting the bankers by creating the greenback, right?
Right.
Right?
That's what lots of people bring up about Lincoln, and that's why I wanted to ask your opinion.
Sure, sure. Those six books that I have in my chapter four, you've really got to get either one of the ones by DiLorenzo. Here's what happened. You know, you've got the 37th Congress, which for the first time is fully Republican. This is the new GOP Republican Party. This isn't the Republican Party of that became the Democratic Republican Party of Jefferson and Madison, okay?
Right.
This is the new – what used to be the Whigs. It became the Republicans when Clay. When Henry Clay, lost his footing, and here comes Lincoln. Okay, and Lincoln's the perfect. He notice what he was. He lifelong attorney to two industries, the railroads and the riverboat owners. Okay, so he's in transportation law. These guys that buy up all this land and go laying rail across it, whether you like it or not. You know, so he's one of these. He's the perfect stooge for them. Now, when they come in during the it's 62, the 37th Congress passes this absurd law saying, "Oh, well, we need money to pay the troops," so they pass the Legal Tender Act, right?
Right.
Well, the Legal Tender Act in what's the name of the? It was 1871. Supreme Court says, I'll remember the case in a minute. Supreme Court in 71, the war, 5 years after the war, 6 years, whatever, after the war, and the court says, you know what, this deal with this paper money, it's got to stop. It really is illegal. We've got to stop this.
Mm-hmm.
And so for a few months, it was illegal to have these greenbacks. But then, by that time, of course, Lincoln was long dead, and Ulysses Grant was president. And what do the bankers do then? They put in two guys, Bradley and Strong, both banker puppets, on the court, and Grant says, "Sure, I'll appoint them," and he does. And just months after the original ruling against paper money, they go right back on themselves, and twice in that year, 71 and 72. I'm sorry, within 1 year of each other, they rule twice. Nope. Paper's cool after all. We were just kidding. Okay. So they go in there and pack the court. These bankers can do what whoever they damn well please.
Absolutely.
They will kill whoever they have to, presidents, you know, whatever, judges, me, I don't care. You know, I'm ready. But these people are ruthless. If you understand how they operate, they, like you said, you know, and this is worldwide, obviously. It's not limited to this country.
These people are gangsters. They're absolutely.
They're gangsters. That's exactly right. And that in 1935, most highly decorated U.S. Marine Corps general, Smedley Butler, wrote a book called War is a Racket. Remember that little book?
It's awesome, only like book. War is a Racket. Actually, that was on my list for the second hour.
Okay. It's just a little bitty booklet. But notice how the words he uses. Notice how he wrote that. He basically says, I could have given Al Capone lessons. This is, and he names all these companies that are using the military like their private militia, like their private, mercenary for free.
He said they
don't even pay anything.
He said he was a racketeer.
Racketeer. Yeah. And he says it again and again. And then he goes all over the country and starts talking about this, and nobody listened to him. And then 25 years later, when 5-star U.S. Army General Dwight Eisenhower, you know, when he's leaving office, he says, he gives that famous speech in 61 when he says, he calls it the military-industrial complex. This is a 5-star general.
Mm-hmm.
Another general saying exactly what 25 years before Smedley Butler had said. These are decorated generals. They know what the hell they're talking about. They're saying, this is racketeering. These people are going to kill you. Yeah, America,
and under the guise of protection, it's under the guise of protection they're going to kill.
Yeah, but it's not always protection. Back in 1837, when Andrew Jackson was giving his farewell, he said, "Watch out for these bankers; they will kill this country." He knew what Hamilton had created. Anyway, this has been going on, guys, for a very long time. And when people think, oh, it's all getting really horrible and terrible, that's why I have chapter 4 in my book. It's called American Idol, and it breaks down the Lincoln presidency, and it gives you 6 books that you can read and 1 website you can go to, and you see, whoa, this all, do you mean we were communists? Do you mean Lincoln and Marx were good friends? Well, I didn't know they even lived at the same time. There were contemporaries and friends that wrote to one another? Yes. Not only that, but 8 out of the 10 points of both Lincoln and Marx's manifesto were already federal policy by the time Woodrow Wilson was president. We were fully communist.
Absolutely.
Communist, like defined by the inventor of communism, guys.
Yeah.
This has been the case for a century.
And people don't know that Karl Marx actually was a journalist here in the States, not over in Europe. And he lost his job, from what I read for making some statements. And he actually asked for a raise. That's crazy stuff. Karl Marx actually worked here in the United States as a journalist.
He was Horace Greeley's top journalist. Yeah.
Right. We're coming up on a break here. So when we come back, we're going to talk a lot more about this. This is fascinating stuff. And this is what more people need to do. They need to study history. And we actually need to start listening to the people who are blowing the whistles, folks. It's been going on for a long time. Hundreds, if not thousands, of people have warned us about this. In fact, our founding fathers talked about it. So when we come back, we're going to have more with David Zuniga, AmericaAgain.net. Go check it out. We will be right back. Stay tuned.
Millions of children born to parents suffering from the sheeple virus. Symptoms include the inability to think for oneself, the attention span of a goldfish, and a strong belief in government and the mainstream media. It is estimated that 1 out of every 2 children are being raised by parents infected with the sheeple virus. But there is a cure. For as little as 19 cents per day, you can become a TFR supporter and help children like me get their daily dose of truth. Together, we will make sure every child has protection from deception.
More than a dozen astronauts have officially reported UFOs. UFOs. Hundreds of hours of UFO footage were filmed by astronauts aboard the space shuttle. Many of these UFOs can only be seen in ultraviolet light. Ultraviolet light. Retired former Apollo astronauts and cosmonauts now tell their stories of their own personal UFO encounters.
We have an unidentified flying object.
The Enigma Channel. Intelligent television for planet Earth. EnigmaTV.com.
Hi everyone, this is Sean from the Awakening Liberty Show. Are you and your family prepared for an emergency? Have you ever thought about investing in food and water storage? Well, if you have, I urge you to check out my one-stop prepper shop. AwakeningLibertyStore.com carries the full line of Legacy Premium, non-GMO, made-in-USA emergency food storage and survival gear. Folks, I've tried them all, and Legacy Premium is the best I've found. Boasting the lowest cost per pound, the lowest cost per calorie, and the largest serving size in the industry, Legacy Premium is simply the best. Not to mention it was voted best tasting in blind taste tests, and I personally concur. Shop AwakeningLibertyStore.com and use coupon code PATRIOT for a special listener discount or call me personally at 775-276-4046. Once again, AwakeningLibertyStore.com. And welcome back to segment two of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on Truth Frequency Radio, your protection from deception. I'm going to open up the phone lines here, and we'll take some phone calls this hour, but we got a lot more to go over with David here, so we're going to actually do that. So just stay tuned. I got a couple callers on the board. Real quick, I want to mention the Awakening Liberty Store. Check it out, AwakeningLibertyStore.com. I got 10% off all the way till June 30th on your entire disc, on your entire basket. We've got 72 hours up to a full year's worth of non-GMO, made in USA, emergency food storage. I've got water storage. I've got filtration systems, survival gear. We also have non-heirloom, non-GMO seed vaults. So come check out AwakeningLibertyStore.com and get 10% off by using coupon code FATHER. Again, that's coupon code FATHER, all lowercase, and again, 10% off. David, before we get back into our conversation here, there's so much we talked about. We kind of got into the banks. And I, you know, it's funny. Bernanke asked the question. He said, if you get rid of the Federal Reserve, what will you replace it with? Now, Ron Paul reportedly answered that, when you surgically remove a cancerous tumor, what do you replace it with? You know, yeah. And I thought that was so terrifying. I my jaw hit the floor, and it's like, okay, America, wake up. Hello, anybody listening? You know, that great. Blows me away. You know, the Federal Reserve, yeah, it still cracks me up today because it was so poignant as to what he said. I wanted to ask you a little bit about the Federal Reserve because I want to get into the indictment engine and really talk about that and the 22 reform laws. But the Federal Reserve and Charles Lindbergh Sr., we were talking about people who have warned us, and I think Charles Lindbergh Sr. did that as well, but nobody listened to him.
Right. Yeah, we have a video, a one-hour full-length movie called America Again, the movie, on YouTube. It's on our website, and we've got that link, a couple of quotes by Lindbergh. Again, I guess I'd like to try to shift, because I know we're going to be short on time here. We're already running against it. I want to shift to the answer instead of going back to the question, the problem, because we could spend a couple of segments on just the money issue.
Right.
But I'd like to describe America again, okay, and then get into how we're going to work just this coming year, in the next 12 months, so that people see, whoa, there's an answer and it's action and I want to do this, okay? So I'd like to do that and then take callers because I know we're going to run out of time. And then if we have time or if somebody else brings up the Fed issue, we can get into the money and banking issue. Is that cool with you?
Absolutely. And we're going to have to schedule a part two because everything that you're doing is, you know, we need to keep promoting this and get people involved.
Great. Yeah, love to. Okay, so America Again, what is it? It's a perpetual charitable trust. Okay, we are domiciled on the island of Nevis in the town of Charlestown, which is the birthplace of Alexander Hamilton. And we did that for two reasons, and we describe that on our website, why we have headquartered there. But we're actually headquartered for operations here in Texas. So we're a Texas LLC, but we are domiciled legally in Nevis for purposes of historical irony and to stick a knife in the heart of Alexander Hamilton and the bankers. Anyway, America Again's it's a perpetual charitable trust, and it's a member organization. So you can join. You pay $9 a month, or you pay $108 a year, or you can pay every 2 months or three or whatever. We've got all kinds of different ways to pay. But as long as you're supporting us, we start supporting you. We're building a brand new website. We're on our seventh website right now, and this new one is going to be really incredible. Anyway, fully interactive, national maps, state maps, breaks things down into forums by town. I mean, really cool. It's going to be very different from what you see right now, but what you see right now is a lot better than the ones we've had in the past, so we're getting there. So our mission, we're here to recruit and educate and then equip and support you and organize you to do four things at the federal level. Number one, bring Congress home forever. That's the biggest one. It changes everything. Number two, take back everything that D.C. has stolen from us over the last, 150 years. And that's those 22 reform laws that we cover in Chapter 12 of the book. Number three, provide a mechanism to enforce the Constitution from now on, both with our members of Congress and with the members of our state legislatures, criminally indicting them, okay? That I cover in Chapter 11 of the book, The Indictment Engine, because we may not be able to get to everything. I'll cover it in brief today. And then the fourth item, federal item, is we'll work on the legislative side, not the field side, but the legislative side of restoring the Founding Fathers' constitutional homeland security, which is the militia. In every American city, every American town should have citizen militia. We always should have. We've just dropped the ball. So Oath Keepers is the only group in the country we know of that has enough on the ball right now that we think they're going to make it, and that's going to be the group we will support in getting that field stuff done. But as far as the legislative stuff, we're going to work on that both at the state level and at the federal level. So, because you need to work on the law before you work on the field stuff, or people will not swallow militia. They're chicken. People don't even like the word anymore. So those are the four things. Bring Congress home, take back everything they took from us, provide a mechanism to whack them and put them in prison, and then put our boots on the ground in every town in America again and say, all right, we're the boss now. So at the state level, we have just one thing we're looking at, and we're planning right now to do a national tour coast to coast from north to south all over this country this year, calling the Bring Congress Home Tour. And we're going to hit I don't know how many towns, but for this one objective, get 27 more state legislatures to ratify the original First Amendment. And when they do, it's going to become the 28th Amendment, even though, originally it was the first. So let me explain what that was. The original First Amendment, and this is what you were alluding to earlier, Sean, it stipulates that no congressional district can have more than 50,000 people, like I said before. And so since they they hijacked this in 1929 with their Reapportionment Act. We have to go get that thing ratified now for sure. Now, it's still open under Article 5. It's still open for ratification. It's sitting there, and it has 11 votes. It has 11 ratification votes. So we just need to get 27 more. That'll give us 38, and 38 on 50 is 70, more than 75%. So by the way, the only subject that George Washington actually stood up to speak in plenary session at the Constitutional Convention in 1787 was that issue of apportioned representation having small enough smaller districts than what they had written into Article 1, Section 2, Clause 2 at the time. It said 40,000, and Nathaniel Gorham said, it's too many, and he pushed and pushed on George Washington, and the last day of the convention, Washington finally stood up and said, okay, you know, this really is true. It's too many. We've got to have a smaller. So anyway, it was that important to them, okay? And how did we let this get taken from us in 1929? I don't know. Anyway, so we can go and do this now. And guess what? Congress can't stop it because they already passed it, okay? So there's nothing that Washington, D.C. can do to stop us from ratifying the 28th Amendment now. We just have to go pound the pavement in 27 more state houses. And we have everything lined up. That's in chapters 2 and 3 of the book. I explain how we're going to do it, what we have to do, everything. So once we do that, now we have this huge U.S. House, right? As soon as that happens, that 27th one ratifies, all of a sudden, now we need 6,400 members of the House. What are we going to do? Well, first, we have to create the redistricting maps. We have to create those districts. America, again, is telling the legislatures, we will bring in, we have a specialist firm that does nothing but GIS tiger mapping. They are the largest in the country. They're out of Reston, Virginia, right near D.C. We will bring them in. They will do the redistricting maps free of charge. The state doesn't have to pay for it. We have attorneys that we will pay for. Our membership will pay for all of this if the states will just do it. Just vote yes. Give us the first right in our Bill of Rights back and do it now. So that's what we're going to do this coming, all these next 12 months. That's what we're working on. It's not the Bring Congress Home Act yet. It's just getting the original First Amendment, which will be the 28th. We're calling that Ratify 28. So that's the first step. The second step, now when you have all these people running for office all of a sudden, because now they're these little bitty districts and we can all run, you know, anybody who's got half a brain and who's an honest person, who's got a lot of friends, who knows how to get out and hustle and work, a lot of people can run for office now that would never think of running for office if they think, all right, I'll run, but I'm not moving to D.C. If we can do this Bring Congress Home Act as our first act, then cool, I will run for Congress. And you'll see a million new faces. You'll see so many, you know, people with skill sets, with incredible skill sets that wouldn't dare run for Congress right now. They'll run. Of course they will. If they don't have to leave town, of course they'll run. If they can make 90 grand for a decent job, have a staff of only two, that's all you get. You get only one office, and it's a modest office. It's a regular old lease space, and it has to be in your district. You can only serve two terms maximum, and you get no benefits. So that's what the Bring Congress Home Act is going to stipulate. Those four things. You get half the current pay. You only get two staff members. You only get one office. You get no benefits. Okay? So who needs benefits if you're only going to serve 4 years? I mean, you're doing something for the 50,000 people who live around you. You'll do it. You'll do it for 90 grand a year. I'll do it.
Yeah, public
service. A lot of us will do it. A lot of us will run for the House if it's on this new basis where, you mean I never have to see Washington, D.C., that godless, idolatrous city? Great. I'll serve from here. Okay, so that's the Bring Congress Home Act. That is our big, big target. To get there, we have to get the 28th Amendment passed first. Finish ratifying it. So that's what we're doing. That is, we're going to bring Congress away from D.C. And I unpack all of that in the book, chapter by chapter. I show you how that's going to change the whole world, because Washington, D.C. will not be itself anymore once you take its guts out. So,
yeah, absolutely. And I think you mentioned the other day, you said, go after their game pieces. Let's bring them home. Let's get them on the local level where we can actually watch them a little bit closer, and take the limousines and the Learjet rides and all this stuff away from them.
Exactly.
I think that's a great idea, because and the other thing, the big point, this just boggles my mind. OK, they're in session one third out of the year, yet they're. Their incomes are like 300% of the median income in your middle income families. They're making huge amounts of money with all of these perks. Again, they're in a situation that, you know, they're bought and paid for, in my opinion, and so much corruption is going on.
Sean, you know what you're going to like even less? if you go look at their operating budget, and you're going to see a lot of staffers that make more than they do.
Yeah.
And guess who those staffers are? They're the older people that really know the ropes in D.C. They are completely owned by the K Street law firms and all the big boys. So, and nobody sees them. Nobody even knows they exist. And they make more than, some of them make more than the legislators. So see, when we take them, like you said, everybody now, the House and the Senate are now local. The Senate will be in your state capital. Your two senators will serve, you know, they'll let them office there in the state house. What's wrong with that? And everybody else, Texas, for instance, right now we've got 36. We should have 550 representatives. We have 36.
Well, and that would certainly stem the tide of corruption in the being bought and paid for. I mean, that would have the bankers and the control structure would have to buy off a lot of people.
Well, not only that, but they'd have to be in the local, in a very small local pool where everybody knows everybody. You see, you know, people. Well, and it's not only that though, Sean. The character, the kind of person who will run for office will be a different kind. You will have statesmen now again instead of politicians. The professional politician came about. Well, I won't get into it, but it's an industry. It's an industry. To run for Congress is, you know, it's a career. It won't be a career anymore. You can only serve 4 years. That's it.
Right.
That's it. So it changes everything. See, it doesn't only take, it doesn't only move them far away and make lots of them. So the bankers have a lot of, you know, have to spend a lot of money and put a lot of field people out, but they can't do it without us seeing what they're doing, because they're full time local in town. We can see.
Right.
We can see who goes in their office, who comes out. You know, everything changes, Sean, when we break it up.
Right.
So we have this power. We've always had this power. This doesn't change a thing about our Constitution. This is just us saying, you know what? Who said we can't have a distributed legislature? 40% of American companies now right now work on the basis of virtual offices.
Right.
And so why are we still doing this idiocy, this 19th century, you know, legislative traditions and procedures that are so easy to corrupt? I mean, you want to kill a law? Put it in the calendar committee. Put it in the rules committee for a week. It's dead. You know, these guys know everything is so corrupt because that town is so corrupt. So again, split them up, bring them home forever. They never go back. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Can you imagine a Washington, D.C., never Congress, never there again?
Yeah.
Isn't that just cool? We would have one week, probably. They would have to go for about one, that big, the first big Congress, we'd have to send them over there for about a week, you know, and they'd get their yayas out and say, okay, I got to go to D.C. They'd have to get a big venue, you know, where all 7,000 people can sit. And they will have to sit and work on this one law, the Bring Congress Home Act. And they will have won office by running on that basis. I'm going to vote for the Bring Congress Home Act, and I'm going to come straight back home and serve from this office that I already have leased.
Right.
I've already leased my office space. I know where it is. It's simple.
Yeah, we the people, not we the elite, which is what I see going on.
We the people. It's us. It is now. What the founding fathers called the people's house will be the people's house. And here's the other thing about the whole tech thing is so bizarre that we're not using. 78% right now of the residents in sub-Saharan Africa, barefoot people, have cell phone service. I freaked out when I saw that. 78% of residents of sub-Saharan Africa. You know what they're doing with it? These barefoot African herdsmen, from their cell phone, okay, obviously, they know the weather now, they get to see, you know, but they're taking free English lessons. They don't pay anything more than their cell phone bill. And once they learn English, guess what? They go get medical diagnoses for free.
Right.
For illnesses that used to kill their tribesmen, you know, their mom and dad may have died of it. They go, they read, they know. It's amazing what technology is doing. Guys, why aren't we using it?
Right.
Why are we playing games with it? Why are we sitting around on Facebook arguing with one another when we could? We've got countless PhDs, entrepreneurs, educated people, super skilled women and men right now that, man, you people can do so much more than this. And I just want to show you how. So that's what this book, Fear the People, is about. And it's free, okay? Please download it.
AmericaAgain.net. I definitely recommend everybody go get that. And you know, I think that distraction is by design. I just don't think people want to participate anymore. I want to get into the indictment part of this, where we would actually go after these criminals, because that's what they deserve, is to be indicted and be tried and be put into prison. And I've heard you talk about the spear and shield, going on the offensive. And I think that's really important, because we need to understand that we do have a heck of a lot of power, and it's sitting right there in the Constitution. I have a friend of mine, is an investigative journalist named Jonathan Mark, and he's talking about truth, or amnesty for truth, which means the people involved in these criminal crime organizations, if they come forward and they tell us, look, this is what's going on, we'll give them amnesty. And that's kind of what you're talking about.
That's interesting. Well, I think we segued into it anyway, Sean, because you know, we were talking about bringing them home. Okay, once you bring them home, check this out. Now every legislator is a state legislator. They're all under the aegis, under the jurisdiction of the state criminal court. If they could commit a crime and it's a U.S. senator, doesn't matter. He's home full time. whose jurisdiction is it now? They can't say, oh, well, I have legislative immunity. Want to bet? Go read the law. Go read the Constitution and go see what does it say in there. Oh, look, felonies. It says felonies. Okay, we get you on a felony. It doesn't matter. But now you're home all the time. So for sure, the state penal code now is what gets you. So here's how we do it. The indictment engine. I can't go into it because, number one, we haven't developed it yet. But number two, it's going to take a good while to get all 50 state penal codes harmonized with what they do. So here's how it works, though, basically. The person files a bill, and that bill, let's say it's for the bankers or for the pharma industry or for whatever, any one of the industries, oil and gas, whatever. And like they always do, they don't write them. The oil and gas industry writes them, and they file them. So they come and file it, and we see, our legal section sees immediately that that one tripped the targeting deal. It definitely violates the Constitution. Okay, you go and harmonize that action with whatever charging statutes you dig out of the politician's state penal code, and all the penal codes are different. So you have to do it for every actor in their own state. So it's a lot of work. This part is a lot of work. It just takes a lot of legal staff. So we prepare the pre-indictment package. You target the person, you score it, you score that person, and whenever their score goes into the red and gets really, really high, then you say, all right, we now need to get this to a grand jury, so we need to prepare the pre-indictment package. That means getting a bunch of signatures of victims. So then we get all our America Again members in that district to say, hey, guys, look, he just tripped the wire. This person is about to file this law. Look what it does. In other words, the bad guys, these wealthy guys, Sean, that we all know, you know, run the world, the minute they try something like this now that we have their people on a really short chain back home, we nab them because we see what they did. We harmonize it with the legal code in their state, and we book them. Basically, you're creating charging orders. And so you bring that before our legal section brings that before the state grand jury, and we, you know, ram it through. So if you get them, if, and you could say, but they hadn't passed the law yet. Well, so what do you call that when you're trying to steal from somebody and you're setting everything up? What do they call that?
That's a conspiracy.
It's a conspiracy, right? And it's a criminal. And depending on the size of the end deal that they've got going, let's say it's the communications industry and it's a multi-billion dollar thing. It's just like what they do now. All of them do it, by the way. Well, not all of them, but most of them. They do this insider trading that none of us can do. Martha Stewart got thrown in prison for doing. They know what they're working on, right? They know what legislation they're working on. And so they go buy and sell, depending on whether they're going to short, you know, they'll short the stock or because they know they're about to screw up that industry. It's amazing what they get away with. Okay, it's the same way when they pass laws. They pass these laws to pad the nest of whatever industry. We should be able to book them right now on that stuff. Why aren't we doing it? Well, because we don't have a mechanism. That's what the indictment engine is. And by the way, it works for state legislators too. They're just as corrupt. They work on a smaller, you know, size deals, but it's the same deal. You talk to anybody like me who has worked for 40 years in the halls state legislators, and you'll see the same thing going on. They're just as corrupt.
Absolutely.
So
we're coming up on a break.
You have to have the people.
Hold on. We're coming up on a break because I want to talk a little bit more about this, and I got a caller here that I want to take here at the top of the next segment. And what you're saying is absolutely. This is what needs to happen because what you're saying is that we can indict people on the penal code based on the state, not the federal system, because quite frankly they kind of sit up there and they're immune to everything. But if we do it at the state level, we say, wait a minute, you just committed fraud, you just committed extortion, you basically just you violated the law and committed a felony, and we're going to book you right here. That's what you're talking about, right?
That's correct. And it's the state system that is doing it. We're not talking about citizens' grand juries or anything off the books. We're talking about the regular old state criminal courts.
Absolutely. I think that's the way it needs to run because those guys up there in Washington, they put themselves up on such a high pedestal. And again, I want to say delete the elite, but they think they are immune. They can do whatever they want to do. And I, for one, am absolutely sick of it. I'm just sick of these psychopath wackos who they just think they can rule over us. They don't rule us. They work for us. The Awakening Liberty Show will be right back.
Warning, warning. The following message will destroy your paradigm. Proceed with caution. The apocalypse is upon us, brothers and sisters. The great revealing is now. The people have spoken and will no longer be manipulated by snake oil salesmen, masquerading as talk networks and alternative media. The new standard is set. This is the line in the sand. Stand with us to fulfill the mission to raise the consciousness of humanity. Stand against us and be exposed by the light we shine. We are TFR, your 100% listener-supported station, and the last bastion of unadulterated truth. Join the media shift by becoming a TFR supporter today, and send a clear message that the mission will not be jeopardized by corporate greed. Together, we will stand as protection from deception.
Hello. Are you tired of only owning inanimate objects, frustrated by human relationships that don't grant you the absolute power over life and death? Then you are the ideal candidate for sentient living animals. Why own a member of an inferior species? Well, in the past, animals have revolutionized agriculture, transportation, fashion, even entertainment. Now, thanks to centuries of forced inbreeding and genetic tampering, these ones are good only for companionship and stress relief, which raises the question, if you don't buy this dog, will we kill him? Is that how it works? Do they just get killed if no one buys them? The risk is yours to take. I've been Roger Horton, and please, Have your mammal's genitals removed in infancy without their consent. It's the right thing to do.
Hey, you. Yeah, you. You like listening to podcasts, don't you? Have you ever thought about starting a podcast of your own? If you're a hardcore podcast fan, you probably have, and you've probably got something great to share with the world. I'm Nathan Frazier, and I've created a free online podcasting course for people just like you. Pre-Launch Secrets gives you the top 5 secrets you need to know in order to launch a successful podcast. You'll learn how to create the core concept of your podcast, how to build a solid audience, and how to consistently generate great content for that audience. These are the secrets the pros use when coming up with ideas for their podcasts. And after this course, you'll have them all at your disposal. The course is free. It's taught by me. Enroll today. Go to podcastblastoff.com/course. That's podcastblastoff.com/course. Podcast Blastoff, the future of podcasting.
Freaky Friday with the Woo Crew. Fridays on Truth Frequency Radio.
A bus at one time. Truth and liberty. Fighting the world order and the tyranny. The Awakening Liberty Show is Sean Caron.
Final segment here on the Awakening Liberty Show. What a great show. We've been talking with David. And David, again, I was mispronouncing your last name. It's David is it Zuniga or Zuniga?
Zuniga, yes.
Zuniga. Now I got it right. I apologize for that. I actually heard somebody else pronounce your name, and that's the way I said it. So Zuniga. David Zuniga from America again. David, I have a caller here on the line. I think it's got a question for you. So I'm going to bring him on the air. I believe it's my friend Dave Kelso. David, are you with us today?
Hey, Sean. This is Dave Kelso of PSEC. How are you doing today? And it's great to be on.
Oh, absolutely. It's great to have you on the show. You know, we missed each other on the show a few weeks ago with Ben. But, you know, you got any questions or comments here real quick? Because David and I still have a lot of stuff to go over. But I'm curious as to your perspective on all this.
Well, I wanted to make a few comments. I've been sitting here listening, and it's been absolutely breathtaking and mind-blowing. It's like, I've been referring to 2016 as the year of discovery, and it really hasn't been disappointing. And this is just yet another link in the chain of that, like, unfolding of awareness. Because up until now, you know, as you and I have also discussed in the past, Sean, within, you know, whether you're talking about the truth movement or within Christianity or, you know, whatever else, you've got all this division, all this bickering back and forth. Two people disagree with each other. They start accusing each other. Oh, you're not a real Christian, or you're a shill, or you're a government agent. And there's just, you know, all this division and all this focus on problems. And yeah, it's fine to know about the problems, but the big thing is nobody's been solutions oriented. And now it's like, I've been starting to see a lot of things unfold. Max Egan, if you've ever heard of him, has been more proactive lately. Then there's that one guy that's got the World Citizen Project. And of course, Sebastian Zubcek with TSU, or SU, whatever you want to call it, which you should talk to David about later. And just, you know, now this, it's like all these solutions are unfolding. And even in recent times, ironically, because I know that the FM station for Truth Frequency is out of Denver, there's actually a pastor out of Denver, West Bowles Community Church, I believe it's called. I'm not local to them, but I pick up his sermons on, they've got a sermon archive, he's got like a Vimeo thing, and I found him online. And this pastor is really great, and he's bringing people together, and he's not about all this division and conflict. Like a lot of pastors are all fire and brimstone, and this guy's about bringing people together and, you know, doing what Jesus taught, love your neighbor and all this and that. And I've just been seeing so many people in all these different fields coming together with all these different solutions. And yeah, it's taking a bit of time. Rome wasn't built in a day, obviously, but your guest here is just no exception. And I've just been like sitting here on like the edge of my seat, just like listening to all this breathtaking stuff and just seeing this as yet more proof that, you know, humanity is starting to really wake up and learning to put down their stuff with each other and to really start to come together in unity. And like your guest said, it doesn't take the majority. Your guest is right. That's a common misnomer. Back during the last American Revolution, you know, forgive me if I'm wrong on the figure, but it was something small, something like only 3% even knew what was going on or participated as far as the population. So the majority has never ruled. The majority is sheep and follows. It's always the minority that creates change in this world. The innovators, you know, you've got the Einsteins and the Teslas and the list goes on and on. It's always the minority that creates the change and the majority follows. Hopefully at some point in the future we'll have a fully awakened majority, but, you know, we're not there yet. So thank you, David, for doing the wonderful, awesome work that you've been doing, and I'm really glad that I was able to tune into this and, you know, get a chance to come on and thank you personally. And yeah, this is just absolutely epic and awesome. And I'm almost tempted to like pinch myself, like, God, am I dreaming?
Awesome, David. Cool. I thank you for calling in. And a response from you, David?
Wow. Well, I'm overwhelmed, David. Thank you very much. I usually have seen this, in fact, almost always have seen this as falling forward in the providence of God. God is doing something in this earth, and I think that when we start doing this thing, when we start taking America back and making this America again, I think the people of the world are going to be watching this, noticing we're not using violence, and we are just restoring the law, and they are going to give glory to God, and they are going to, those who are not Christian or whatever, are still going to say, wow, the Americans are doing it again. Look, I want to go to America. You know, we will become that shining city on a hill that we were supposed to have been again. And we owe that to all of those who have been destroyed and whose families have been destroyed by quote unquote our military over the last 130 years. It's been a horrible thing. But remember, they started here. They destroyed our cities first. They took us captive first. They turned us north against south first, okay? And if you see what's happening, liberal, conservative, Christian, atheist, black, white, men against women, you see that. They love that bifurcation. Get the two pieces just about exactly equal, keep them at one another's throats all day, every day, and pick their pocket the whole time. And that's what's been happening to us all this time. Now we're getting smart. And like I said about represent.us, I don't agree with their social policy, with any of that, but I love what they're doing about local and state corruption. And so I say, praise God for represent.us. And I hope they say the same thing about AmericaAgain.net. But we can stand together. And by the way, we do want to be standing together. We're going to hit all on one day. We won't say what day it is. But all on one day in the 50 state houses, we're going to be standing and issuing a proclamation from the people to the people who work in those state houses for us under those celestial domes. And we're going to be telling them, this is how it's going to be now. We're going to do it in the same hour in those 50 state houses on the front steps, weather permitting, you know, may have to be inside the portico in some of them. And we won't say what day yet, but that's coming. And it's going to be amazing. And, you know, if Hillary's in, that's okay. That's cool. God knows what he's doing. I mean, but if Trump is in, that's cool too. I don't love either of those people. I think Trump is a lot more, you know, ostentatious and all of that. And I believe that he could get a lot more done for our side, but not necessarily. You know, I don't care about that. Presidents do not rule this country. The bankers and the K Street law firms that work for industry rule this country right now. That is what we need to stop. And it doesn't matter who's in the White House. It really, really doesn't. They can follow us or not follow us. But it's up to the people. This is for us to do, folks. It's for us to do. So here's how we're going to do it. God willing and providing. We're in about 100 communities right now. I think 98 communities. Our goal is 2,500 America Again towns by March 2017. So you join, and you can join by just go to AmericaAgain.net. It says join and click, and you can join. Okay. Once you join, please download the book, Fear the People, and start reading it. Because if you don't, you don't know what you're doing. You're just kind of joining. Oh, boy, we're going to do something. Well, you need to know what you're going to do, right? First thing you need to do, get three other people in your town to join. So that now, even if it's just by email, even if it's just a phone call or a text every now and then, you know you've got some buds. You've got some friends in your town. You're standing together. You don't feel like a weirdo all alone. And now there's four of you. And once you do that, we have a proclamation that we're going to read, like I said, on 50 state house steps on the same day all over America. And that proclamation needs to be signed. Each sheet needs 10 signatures on it, okay? So each of you gets just 10 people to sign. That doesn't mean they're joining America Again. They're just signing this proclamation saying, you will ratify our original right in our Bill of Rights. You will do this now, okay? So that's the proclamation. You get 10 people on that clipboard, you know, on that sheet. And the four people get 10 each, so you get 40 per town, and we want to have 2,500 towns, okay? So, and again, it doesn't matter that you have, 40 times 25, 100,000 signatures, because they wouldn't all be in one state, of course, but, and they'll be split all over the place. But it'll be a thick stack of papers that we are holding in our hand when we issue those 50 proclamations, the same words in the same hour in all 50 states, okay? That is going to be an historic day for the people of this country, standing up left, right, black, white, men, women, whatever. We're standing together and saying, you know what? We gotcha. We're flipping this thing over. Now, I do this in the name of Christ the Lord, but I don't care if you do it in the name of your face in the mirror or your plastic lawn chair or whatever, but you're doing it because we owe it to ourselves, to our kids, to our grandkids, and to the rest of the watching world. We don't have to do what you just said, David, a minute ago. We don't have to be at one another's throats anymore. We just don't have to do this.
And that's the promise of this all. And what David was saying, and I concur, is that I am starting to see some unification, and I'm starting to see people wake up. In fact, I used to do this quite often, David, is I would ask 10 people just off the street, you know, is the Federal Reserve part of the federal government? Well, it used to be that 9 of them would say yes. It's now becoming 6 and 7 out of 10. So there are people that are realizing that there is this corruption, that there is this evil, that there is something opposed to our freedoms and liberties. And I think it's beautiful that people are, I don't like to say waking up. They're coming about. They're going, wait a minute, this isn't the way this was supposed to be. And I have often said that the system isn't broken. It was designed this way. And I am starting to think about that again, because quite frankly, I don't know that it was designed that way. It's just this lack of understanding about how it is supposed to work. And I think, again, that's by design.
Yeah, read my book, and then read the book. I have 68 book. I have synopses of 68 books in the back of my book. You know, a short description of the book, why you should read it, what the basic thesis is. And it's kind of people ask, how do you know all this stuff? Where'd you learn? And I just show you, if you had to have a library and were living on an island and wanted to know, you know, the very best that can be known today about self-government, I would read these 68 books. That's what I would read. Now, I'm not saying I've left many, many out because people won't read 160 books. But anyway, in there you'll find that I think it's like you said, John, it really, the system is not rigged to not work. But like I said about Hamilton, he was there at the very beginning. And he was the banker's boy. Look, his crypt is on Wall Street for a reason. He lived on Wall Street. He worked on, I mean, he was the banker's boy from the start. And banking, those people are, as an industry, it has to be the single most evil in the history of mankind. And there's lots of books about that, videos about it, etc. But that is the problem. Now we go to solutions and say, all right, there's 320 million of us. Let's say we get a million of us together. Boy, that's a tiny little group. No, it's not. That's a million people pulling on the same end of the rope. You know what that does in the world today? Gosh, with what we have right now, with the tech we have right now, if you get 10,000 people pulling on the same end of the rope with the kind of mechanism I'm talking about here, you can do amazing things. So this is, by the way, this is anything but politics. When people say, I had to, one of our volunteer staff the other day said, oh, cool, you know, I've never been a political activist until now. and I said, hey, I take exception to that insinuation. This is not politics. This is self-government. And that's not politics. You're not a political activist if you're governing yourself and the people under you the way you always should have. That's not politics. That's life. That's life in America. That is, you know, that's what it is when you say popular sovereignty. That's what it is to be sovereign when the people are sovereign. So here's political activism. People that say either it's for a particular person, you know, a candidate, or it's for a party. And you do it every year for your party. You either lobby or pressure or threaten or do petitioning or recall elections or class action lawsuits or whatever. That's politics. And you say to yourself, well, I'm making a difference. No, you're not. You know, or I'm furthering a worthy cause. Yeah, maybe one cause that they're going to push you back 3 years from now. You're not gaining anything. You're putting your finger in a hole in the dike and pretty, you know, it's not going to do anything. That you may further the platform of your quote-unquote worthy party. That party is bunk. So again, this is America. Again, is a new way of life. It's a new way of living in America. That's why it's called America Again. It's going back to fulfill the duties and the power that we have inherent in just being an American. It has a responsibility. So the people themselves have the ultimate power in this place. Let the world see that, and let it be a peaceful thing, very powerful, but still peaceful. And no people in developed civilization today, anywhere on this earth, can do this. Even if they want to, they can't. They don't have this constitution, large C, capital C constitution. They don't have that. We do. This is a blessing that we owe the rest of the world to say, now, when you have one of these, here's what you do with it. And you go and you do the duty that you're supposed to do. It's the law stipulated there.
Right.
Okay, so if we start doing that, Sean, I love your show, by the way. I love your ads. I love your bumper music. I love the ad with the little kid. It is so great that, you know, people who are looking for solutions are willing to start also blowing the whistle on people that are absolutely treacherous. They aren't looking for solutions. They're making money off of, you know, the quote-unquote conservative talk industry. And it's an industry that's gotten big and fat and lazy and, you know, doing all kind, having to get weirder and weirder just to get people to watch or listen. And it's ridiculous.
And they continue to do it based on, I've thought about this with Rush. Rush is not stupid. He knows what's going on. I mean, I followed him back in California and Sacramento when I grew up with him, listening to him on the radio. But his whole livelihood depends on this Cloward Piven divide and conquer false left-right paradigm. And he's bamboozled so many people. I mean, he got 20 million listeners a day? You know, we're sitting here streaming maybe a couple thousand. There'll be lots more on archives and on YouTube. But we need to get people to stop. We need to get those people who have been bamboozled over to America Again and over to the idea of this is not the way this should be working, and we have the power to get back to it.
Well, amen. You know, and I think of Joe Farah. I look at, you know, I've contacted Joe. We used to email back and forth after he wrote his book, Taking America Back, in 2004. I was so impressed with it. And boy, you know, he totally cut me off and totally, you know, I don't see a news story here, David, with America Again. I don't see a story. There's nothing I can report. Farah has 32.4 million uniques per year. I mean, per month. 32.4 million.
Wow.
Half again more than Rush. Between his three big outlets, WorldNet Daily, Western Conservatism, and whatever the other, Christian Tribune, or whatever, Conservative Tribune. He's the guy that I look at and I say, okay, Joe Farah, you owe the body of Christ an answer for why you have put off America Again three times in the last 6 years and said, David, I don't see a story here. There's nothing to report. That is so treacherous. Now, here's a Christian man doing this in the light of day. I'm sorry. He's not getting away with it. Not with me. So our mission is to correct our own abdication. And I start with big dogs like Farah. And you can start with big dogs like Rush Limbaugh. But all of us, man, all of us have just, we sit here and we wait for somebody else to do something. Not going to happen. It's your job to get this done. So I'll show you, read my book. I'll show you every step. But now you have to actually go do it in your town. Just your town. Don't go look around anywhere. Your town.
Yeah, let's get it on the community level. You know, Patrick Henry was one of my favorite founding fathers because he was seriously concerned about much of what was going on with the framing of the Constitution. But he was quoted as saying, "Guard with jealous attention the public liberty. Suspect everyone who comes near that precious jewel. Unfortunately, nothing will preserve it but downright force." And I want to say enforcement. I want to put that enforcement on there. He says, "We'll preserve it, but downright force." When you give up that force or enforcement, you are ruined. And I think he is very accurate. And I love what America Again is talking about, because it isn't by force. This isn't a guns and tanks and cannons revolution. This is enforcement of what has already been proclaimed, what has already been put down in law. And we just need to enact it and defend this Constitution for what it says and the power that it gives us.
Well said. There's a lot more in the book. If you will please download the book, Fear the People, it's at the bottom of the homepage on the right-hand side, blue button. Download it for free. There are three videos on our homepage, and the long one is the middle one, I think. It's America Again, the movie. And in that movie, it's an hour long, I go into the set. Well, Harvey Gold, our wonderful voiceover actor, goes into the seven major felony crimes that Congress is committing right now, today, every day. Seven classes of felony crime. And it just walks you through them. And you see it and you go, wow, this is horrible. Okay, that is what we're abdicating on. We're over that and we're just watching it. So the big red button on our homepage, push that. Yeah, the one that says take action, click on that, okay? And you'll see instructions there for joining our national conference call. We have a conference call every Sunday night at 8 p.m. Central, okay, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. So join us on Sunday nights. Chime in. Tonight's is going to be a doozy. It's going to be really good. We're talking about the local, what we're doing right now and how to do it, okay? So if you want to join us in a couple hours, be there. Click the big red button, shows you. I mean, I can tell you right now, for those of you that have something to write with, dial 712-775-7031. And then when it asks you for the passcode, it's 123-277-344. And it's always those same numbers every Sunday. So join us on Sunday nights.
And would you send me those numbers, please, on Facebook,
yeah,
and I'll put those out there. And I want to tell everybody that there are three videos on AmericaAgain.net. I recommend you watch all three of them. You can watch them on YouTube. Hit that share button. hit the share button. Let's get this stuff viral. Let's get people understanding what is going on and what David's vision is for America and how we can restore our republic, because it is certainly in jeopardy. So, you know, I want to thank you so much for being on the show and sharing with us your vision, your ministry, and your dedication and activism. It's heartwarming.
Well, thanks, Sean. I'd love to come back, and it's been a lot of fun.
Most definitely, and I will invite you back. We'll do a part two, because I want to get into this. Real quick, we're running out of time, but, you know, you talked about those seven things that basically our government is doing that are felonies, that are crime, and that really show them as to be a crime organization. Do you know those off the top of your head? Can you rattle through them real quick?
No, I don't. I don't keep them on the top of my head, because I've got too many other lists on the top of my head. But, I mean, it's basically counterfeiting, fraud, grand theft. There's
privacy,
I don't remember, but there are seven of them. As you see each one, you say, oh yeah, how about that one? Oh yeah, what they're doing with the IRS? Oh yeah, what they're doing here? And you look at it. The whole Fed one is a major one, the counterfeiting one, which is I think the second one that we do.
Right.
And when we walk you through how they did the deal. The Fed was 51 years after the fact. They did the deal during the war, okay? And they said, all right, we're going to make fake money, and we're going to take all your gold. While we're making this fake money, we're going to hypothecate that gold that you've got.
Right.
And that's what they did, and they've been doing it ever since. And it's just absurd how long this has gone on. And we think that it was just when they started the Fed in 1913. It was not. It was 1862. 37th Congress did it, and there were a bunch of bankers involved with the 37th Congress, and Lincoln signed off happily, gladly, and now everybody says, oh, see, he was against the bankers because he had the greenback.
Right.
The greenback was an illegal piece of paper.
Yeah, it's a fiat currency. Absolutely. Everybody go and check out the videos on AmericaAgain.net. And again, thank you so much, David, for joining us on the show today. Fear the People and This Bloodless Liberty by David Zuniga. Did I say that right?
That's okay.
Zuniga.
Just fine.
I apologize for that. Again, thank you so much for being on the show and fighting for this constitutional republic, fighting for our liberty, and fighting for our freedom. It's great to see people out there doing this, and we got to get people involved. And stay in touch with me. Let's do a part two, and I would like to get involved in my local community, and I will check that out. So again, AmericaAgain.net. David, thank you so much for being on the show. Coming up next week, I'm going to have, arguably viral, Ask Jenny, she knows, and her father. If you haven't seen it, go to Facebook and check it out. And he talks about a lot of stuff. And I do want to mention that one of those criminal activities is fabricated wars based on false flag events, as we talked about 9/11 earlier. I am certainly all aboard with 9/11 truth. It wasn't what they told us it was. Again, until next week, may God bless you and keep you all. Until then, thank you for listening.